Ecology or Catastrophe, The Life of Murray Bookchin, by Janet Biehl, published by Oxford University Press, 2015. Chapter 2, Labor Organizer. In 1938 Trotskyists worldwide, claiming to be the authentic heirs of the Bolshevik Revolution, had formed their own Fourth International, so as to rally the working class to a genuine proletarian revolution. The following year, as Hitler invaded Poland, the Trotskyists predicted that this incipient new European war would follow the scenario of the Great War. Once again Germany was the aggressor. Once again the main belligerents were imperialist countries competing for hegemony. So close were the parallels, in fact, that the new war seemed to be a mere continuation of the first. That being the case, Trotskyists resolved to follow the playbook that had worked so well for the Bolsheviks in 1917. The Bolsheviks had opposed the first imperialist war, so the Trotskyists of 1939 would oppose the second. And just as the war-weary Russians had rallied to the anti-war Bolsheviks in 1917, so the sooner or later war-weary proletariat would eventually rally to the Trotskyists, who would oppose this war. This was the tried and tested program, as American Trotskyist leader James Page Cannon labeled it. And just as the first imperialist war had led to revolution, so too would the second. Indeed, given that capitalism seemed to be teetering, the second imperialist war would likely end in multiple revolutions, the proletariat in the various Western countries would demolish capitalism, the Russian proletariat would overthrow Stalin's regime, and the German workers would overthrow the Nazis. The war, Trotsky predicted confidently in July 1939, would provoke with absolute inevitability the world revolution and the collapse of the capitalist system. And the Fourth International's program, he affirmed, would be the guide of millions, and these revolutionary millions will know how to storm earth and heaven. Radical intellectuals on several continents rallied to the banner of the Fourth, dazzled by acumen of the Russian Revolution's theoretical mastermind, the commander of the Red Army, and not least the author of the Great History. He was the paragon of the activist intellectual, a man of letters who had also led troops against a reactionary enemy and prevailed. For the past decade Stalin had subjected him to a slanderous propaganda campaign and dispatched agents over three continents to murder him, yet his defiance had never faltered. His courage was breathtaking. For all these reasons, Bookchin would recall years later, Trotsky won my deep admiration and ideological support. In early 1940, the Fourth International's largest branch was the American one, the Socialist Workers' Party, SWP, with 2,500 members, and New York was its largest section. This was the group that had organized the counter-demonstration at Madison Square Garden. The New York SWPRs actively supported Trotsky at his refuge down in Coyoacan, purchasing a house for him there, supplying bodyguards, and sending him money. They maintained an ongoing correspondence with him and journeyed to meet with him. We were in very, very intimate contact with him after he came to Mexico, wrote Cannon. Meetings of the New York SWP, held at National Party headquarters at 116 University Place, were attended by luminaries like the philosophers Sidney Hook and James Burnham, the journalists Dwight MacDonald and George Brightman, and many others. They made Trotskyism for a time the leading American radical movement in terms of per capita brain power. One of the brightest stars in the firmament of the New York SWP was Jean Van Hyenoord, a Frenchman with a Dutch name who had been Trotsky's international corresponding secretary throughout the 1930s, traveling with him from one place of exile to another. More recently in 1940, Van, as he was called, had married a New Yorker and moved to the city where he now frequented SWP meetings. With his revolutionary glamour, Van dazzled 19-year-old Bookchin. "I knew Trotsky's secretary," he would exult to me 50 years later. Bookchin was also honored to befriend Felix Morrow, age 34, the author of Revolution and Counter-Revolution in Spain, and Al Goldman, 43, who had been Trotsky's attorney during the Dewey Commission inquiry. He found a same-age comrade in Dave Eisen, a budding journalist. Stalin, with his murderous collectivizations, his show trials, and his gulags, was turning the dream of socialism into an abattoir, but Trotsky taught his followers around the world that Stalin was merely an aberration. As Bookchin's new friend Goldman remarked, Trotsky wrote and explained, and we read and understood and continued the struggle. Trotsky was the bearer of revolutionary hope. As the socialist author George Lichtheim observed, Trotskyism stood for the utopian side of communism, belief in an imminent world revolution. Not that Trotsky was above criticism, even to his New York supporters. In 1918-19, after the revolution, he and his fellow Bolsheviks had banned factions within their own party, suppressed all non-Bolshevik political parties, and formed the Cheka, the secret police. When the New York SWPRs questioned him about these measures, he explained that they had been historically necessary. Perhaps most troubling was the Red Army's brutal and bloody suppression of the dissident pro-democracy movement at the Kronstadt naval base in 1921. This brave, principled sailors' revolt had been smashed by none other than Leon Trotsky himself. When the Americans asked him how he could possibly justify this action, he responded, "How could a proletarian government be expected to give up an important fortress to reactionary peasant soldiers?" Dwight MacDonald, unsatisfied with this response, challenged him, whereupon Trotsky shut down the discussion, "Everyone has the right to be stupid on occasion, but Comrade MacDonald abuses it." In fact, Trotsky had no more interest in democracy or civil liberties than had Lenin or Stalin. But the SWPRs nonetheless gave the old man the benefit of the doubt. Their devotion both to him and to the coming neo-Bolshevik revolution was unbounded. "Our whole lives revolved around the party," one comrade, Sidney Lenz, recalled. And even though Trotsky himself was dogmatic and rigid, his New York followers were boisterously disputatious, dissecting even the tiniest differences of opinion among themselves in protracted discussions. Under a Trotskyist regime, they all would have been shot. Bookchin felt at home in this hyper-articulate enclave, where political life and personal life once again converged. Much to his regret, however, he couldn't attend SWP meetings regularly, he had to go to work. In late 1939 he had dropped out of high school to take a job in industry, not only to earn a living but to help carry out Trotsky's injunction to organize the proletariat for the coming, inevitable revolution. So early on weekday mornings he commuted from the Bronx apartment, which he still shared with his mother, to Bayonne, New Jersey, where he toiled from 8 to 5 in a foundry. Their work conditions were brutal, the heat was intense and searing, the noise mind-numbing, and the air laden with hazardous substances. Bookchin's job was to pour molten metal from a hot furnace into molds, arduous, punishing work, requiring great physical strength and stamina. The heat scorched his face, and the heavy load strained his 5'5" frame. "During those years," he told me, "the work was so hard that he was always underweight." But the SWP exhorted its members not only to perform the work but to excel at it, after all, in order to gain the respect and confidence of their fellow workers, eventually to recruit them, they must be the best workers on the job. Bookchin would not let the revolution down by slacking. He did manage to get to SWP meetings sometimes, although not as often as he would have liked. His grueling job left him exhausted at day's end, barely able to stay awake on the train home, let alone sit through a meeting. Often he could muster just enough energy to deliver his mother's daily insulin injection, Rose was by now a diabetic, before collapsing into bed, for a few hours sleep, then rise in the dark to repeat the ordeal the next day. In 1940 the United Electrical Workers, the CIO union for which Bookchin had tried to organize in Jersey City, set up a local in Bayonne, and Bookchin and his fellow foundry workers were proud to join. The local elected him shop steward, which meant that he handled their grievances about pay and working conditions. Most of his fellow workers were African Americans, and he felt a special urgency to defend them against racial discrimination. A black worker named Alec became a particular friend. At one point the company was about to fire Alec, and the white UE president, very racist, did nothing to prevent it, but Bookchin defended him and saved his job. Even as he was pouring metal and handling grievances, Bookchin was also trying to enroll new members for the SWP. As a party member himself, he had the revolutionary task of actively propagating Trotskyist ideas to workers, attempting to persuade them to attend SWP lectures and classes and if possible to join. That was no mean feat in the UE, a union whose leadership was militantly Stalinist. Nonetheless, away from the Stalinists' earshot, Bookchin talked up the SWP to any foundry workers who would listen, during lunch hours, after work, and maybe even at grievance meetings. If they showed any interest, he would patiently explain the basic principles of Marxism. He tried to persuade them to form a study group, where theory, not just practical issues of wages and working conditions, could be discussed. But most of the foundry workers, he found, merely tolerated that kind of talk at best, perhaps out of friendship or perhaps even out of curiosity. He had at least one success: Archie Lieberman, a UE organizer, joined the SWP. But for the most part, the Bayonne foundrymen felt no urgent need to prepare themselves for a revolution or to join the neo-Bolshevik cause. Back in New York, the Trotskyist intellectuals were arguing over a new development. In November 1939, Stalin had invaded Finland, a small peaceable country that posed no threat to the Soviet Union. Outraged, Max Schachtman, a leading Trotskyist who had co-founded the SWP along with James P. Cannon, condemned the invasion as an act of imperialist aggression. Most of the SWP intellectuals agreed with him, and they certainly expected that Trotsky would concur. Down in Coyoacan, however, Trotsky heard of their objections, and shot back his disapproval. The invasion, he said, was not imperialistic. The Soviet Union, despite Stalin's atrocities and his hideous regime, was still the home of the Bolshevik Revolution. It was still a socialist state, Lenin's nationalization of industry remained in place. It was therefore by definition incapable of imperialism. And it was therefore by definition superior to bourgeois democratic Finland. So the invasion was justified, and so was Stalin's invasion of Eastern Poland, for that matter. Trotsky insisted that his followers endorse both. Max Schachtman refused to approve either of those acts of naked aggression. The Soviet Union had nothing at all to do with socialism anymore, he retorted to Trotsky. By no stretch of the imagination was it a workers' state. It was a prison camp, a charnel house ruled by latter-day tsars, a modern despotism of immense proportions drenched in blood. It was entitled to no support whatsoever from anyone. But Trotsky tolerated no deviations in his followers, and in the New York group, it was James P. Cannon who carried out the task of enforcing orthodoxy. At an SWP convention in April 1940, Cannon insisted that the assembled Trotskyists endorse the two Soviet invasions. Disgusted, Schachtman walked out, taking most of the stellar intellectuals along with him. Once outside, they formed a new, separate Trotskyist party which they called the Workers' Party. Some of the New Yorkers, however, chose to remain in Cannon's SWP. Among them were Al Goldman, Felix Morrow, Jean Van Hyenuert, Dave Eisen, and Murray Bookchin. Their reasoning is unknown to me, but surely one purpose for staying would have been to affirm their loyalty to the hero of the Russian Revolution, to this group of friends and comrades. That transcendent fact still meant a great deal. A few months later, in August 1940, Trotsky was sitting at his desk in Mexico penning a diatribe against the imperialist war, when a Stalinist agent crept into the room and plunged an ice axe into his brain. A few hours later, he died in a hospital. Stalin had finally achieved his goal of killing off the entire Bolshevik revolutionary leadership from 1917. When Bookchin heard the news of the death of Leon Trotsky, he was undoubtedly heartbroken. The whole Fourth International plunged into deep mourning. But the Second Imperialist War was underway, so even in its grief the Fourth recommitted itself to carrying out Trotsky's program, indeed with ever more fervor, to transforming the imperialist war into an international socialist revolution. The Stalinists, for their part, were taking an entirely different position. In June 1941, Hitler tossed aside his pact with Stalin and did what the Soviet dictator had so long feared: he invaded the Soviet Union. Stalin then joined the Allied cause. The Comintern parties, including the CPUSA, were delighted to find themselves finally on the anti-fascist side of the war, and overnight they became enthusiastic supporters of the Allied war effort, favoring U.S. involvement as well. In late 1941, as war raged in Europe, Bookchin, aged 20, took the curious step of joining the Merchant Marine. He had a romantic notion of seeing the world from the prow of a ship, he later told me, like the self-educated socialist Jack London, whom he much admired. But it seems to have been a strange moment for tourism, and I have come to suspect he had another reason as well. Trotsky's old international secretary, Jean van Hyenuert, still carried on an extensive correspondence with Trotskyists around the world. Once the war made international postal delivery impossible, Van recruited comrades to join the Merchant Marine and form a network of couriers. Perhaps Bookchin, who admired Van, joined in order to participate in that network of mail carriers. For whatever reason, Bookchin obtained his seaman's certificate on December 3, 1941, and prepared to ship out on a coastal freighter the next day. That night some of his friends took him out drinking, to give him a hearty send-off, they said. The Muscatel flowed, and convivial Bookchin polished off glass after glass, while his friends surreptitiously dumped theirs. He got roaring drunk, and the next day, as his friends intended, he was too hungover to report for duty. He missed the boat. 4 days later, Imperial Japan bombed Pearl Harbor, and the United States entered World War II. On December 11, Hitler declared war on the United States. Wolf packs of Nazi U-boats along the Atlantic seaboard fired torpedoes at any merchant ship whose silhouette appeared, in their periscopes, against the glittering shoreline. Burned-out carcasses of American ships soon littered Atlantic beaches. Had Bookchin gone to sea on December 4, his ship would likely have become one of those easy targets. His friends had undoubtedly saved his life. He put his seaman's certificate in a frame, and for the rest of his days, wherever he lived, it would hang on the wall over his desk, as a reminder to myself not to do anything stupid. Once the United States entered the war, most Americans embraced the Allied cause enthusiastically. 50 million American men were drafted, with minimal resistance. Among the most ardent supporters of the war were the American Stalinists, who tried to make up in energy what they lacked in numbers. The Stalinist leaders of the UE, for instance, full-throatedly supported the war effort to defend the socialist fatherland. But the Trotskyists remained firm in their definition of the war as imperialist rather than anti-fascist, and in their commitment to leading an international proletarian revolution against ruling class in all the major warring states. Trotskyists were not conscientious objectors, opposed to all war as such. On the contrary, Trotsky had encouraged his followers to join their respective armies, to learn to fight in preparation for the revolutionary conflict and to recruit new comrades from among their fellow soldiers. Their position, rather, was to oppose the imperialist war as such, following the tried and true program, and refuse to take sides in it. Murray was exempted from the draft because his diabetic mother depended on him for her daily insulin injections, but he made himself useful as a civilian, channeling his energy into instigating the revolution in Bayonne. Once the United States entered the war, American factories converted quickly to war production and sought to intensify it. They demanded that workers toil for longer hours and faster. But the workers, now unionized in the CIO, were eager to keep the pace of production and working conditions reasonable. Their only muscle was the strike, and in 1941 more American workers went on strike than in any year since 1919. They saw no contradiction between patriotism and an insistence on decent working conditions. Government and industry fought back, appealing to American workers to patriotically sacrifice their right to strike for the duration of the war. In December 1941, the Roosevelt administration asked them to voluntarily take a no-strike pledge. The leadership of the CIO unions, who were mostly Stalinists, were delighted to comply and took the pledge, No mere workers' discontents, in their view, should be permitted to obstruct the war effort. And the UE leaders were among the happiest. By 1940-41, the UE was the main communist fortress in the labor movement. Its leadership permitted no strikes at all and demanded stepped-up war production from its members. The Trotskyists, however, had no intention of complying with the no-strike pledge, not by a long shot. Fomenting strikes was basic to their program of instigating and leading proletarian revolution against all ruling classes. So they rejected the pledge, which they considered class collaboration, and continued to promote revolutionary labor militancy. The UE leaders, annoyed, wanted to tame obstreperous locals like Bayonne and to that end invoked the no-strike pledge, denying the right of the locals to strike. As Murray's fellow Bayonne organizer Archie Lieberman put it, the UE Stalinists were the worst strike breakers. The Bayonne rank and file, however, scorned the no-strike pledge and elected Bookchin to serve on the District 4 Council to uphold the right to strike. There he clashed with the Stalinists, who had a practice of positioning their comrades strategically at meetings and attempting to overawe dissenters like him with vituperation and character assassination. When that failed to faze Bookchin, they offered to pay him for his heretofore unpaid work as a shop steward. He declined to be bought off. Instead, he threw himself into exhorting his fellow foundry workers to mount a political strike against the imperialist war. He talked to them about communism, they listened and nodded. Then when he paused to take a breath, they told him about their grievances concerning working conditions and wages. They had no interest in overthrowing capitalism, they wanted to strike, but only for immediate practical goals. No matter how much he tried, he couldn't awaken a revolutionary spirit in them. Far from joining the SWP, they always drifted away. And that was very, very shaking to me. At least he could find solace at SWP headquarters. Doubtless after a hard day of futile agitating, it felt good to sit down and relax at his political home on University Place. Sometime in 1941 or 1942, as he sank into a chair, Bookchin might have noticed a new man in the SWP meeting room. Small in stature, he looked a bit like Richard Wagner, an effect enhanced by the heavy German accent and a certain flamboyance. The man talked animatedly to the comrades clustered around him, explaining the political situation in Europe, and fascinating them with tales of his own narrow escapes from the Gestapo. But probably not even the charismatic German could keep Bookchin's weary eyes open for long. Let's allow him to rest as we catch up with the life of Joseph Weber, whose name Murray would always pronounce Weber, the German way. Born in 1901 in the industrial Ruhr, young Weber had been an incorrigible rebel who, like Bookchin, dropped out of secondary school but later educated himself, an autodidact. Elated by the Bolshevik Revolution, he had joined the German Communist Party or KPD, while Rosa Luxemburg was still alive. Murray would later marvel. But in the 1920s, he realized that Stalin was creating a new tyranny, and by 1929, when Stalin sent Trotsky into exile from the USSR, Weber had become one of Trotsky's ardent international supporters. Meanwhile, he earned his living as a bandmaster, composer, and pianist, harboring a special love for Wagner's operas. In late February 1933, just after Hitler became Chancellor of Germany, the Nazis outlawed leftist parties. Police arrested every KPD member they could find and sent them all to concentration camps. The several hundred German Trotskyists escaped the initial wave of persecution because of their relative obscurity. Apparently, the Nazis weren't familiar with Trotskyists at first. Some of them bravely tried to organize the proletariat to rise up in revolt against Hitler, handing out flyers near factories. But most German Trotskyists, like Weber himself, fled the country, finding homes in various European cities. Taking the name International Communists of Germany, IKD, the scattered émigrés formed a coordinating committee called the Auslandskommite, AK. The AK of the IKD, as Murray would always call it, established a newspaper, Unser Word, Our Word, to report on the German situation to the rest of the world and to appeal for help. Published first in Prague and then in Paris, most issues of Unser Word led off with an article by Trotsky analyzing developments and prescribing strategies. In late 1933, Joseph Weber decamped to Paris, where he began writing for Unser Word under the cover name Jar. He quickly rose to become the paper's co-editor. Trotsky, who at that time was living in France, endorsed the publication of Unser Word as a great achievement and its strategy as correct. From their vantage point in Paris, the IKD émigrés watched in horror as the Nazis terrorized the German proletariat into submission and criminalized labor agitation. The Gestapo arrested anyone who tried to distribute leaflets or, after realizing that Trotskyists were communists too, Unser Word. Once they decimated the left, the Nazis proceeded to ban all other non-Nazi political parties, cultural institutions, and social organizations as well. Only one sector of German society seemed to be putting up a fight against Nazi domination, the churches. As a good Marxist, Joseph Weber was astonished and puzzled by the very existence of church resistance, but he also wondered, can or must we support it? In late 1934, he and his fellow German Trotskyist exiles assembled in Switzerland for a meeting, where he told them that since the proletariat had proved unable to fight the Nazis, the IKD must fully support the only oppositional tendency in Germany that could potentially achieve mass support, the churches. Indeed, he said, the IKD must support any movement that contested the fascist state, whatever it might be. His comrades' response was outrage. Marxists rejected organized religion, they reminded him. The factory, not the church, was the proper arena for struggle. Some walked out, accusing the IKD and Weber of betraying the very fundamentals of Marxism. But those who remained in the IKD entrusted the leadership of the AK to Weber and his close comrade Otto Schussler, who now became its central figures. As a man, it must be said, Weber was notable for his self-confidence, especially when my mostly unusual opinions proved themselves more and more to be well-founded. To his great credit, he was open-minded enough to discard Trotskyist orthodoxy when it no longer corresponded to reality. But much to his frustration, his friends were by no means always in agreement with my views, and to get his way, he complained, he sometimes had to drag them along after me. Hence some remembered him as rigid and intolerant. He was given to supercilious harshness, dismissing those who disagreed with him as backward elements and newcomers. Their observations were absurd and laden with all the usual petty bourgeois gossip and dirt. That is, he was prone to insult. In the AK of the IKD, vitriolic faction fights became a way of life. But as he debated or insulted his critics, Weber could always righteously point out that he had the support of the one who mattered most. I agree, as you may know, with Jar on the disputed questions, Leon Trotsky wrote of him in a 1936 letter. In 1937, Trotsky praised the really excellent articles that came from Jar's pen. Asked to take sides in another quarrel in the IKD, Trotsky said, "I haven't the slightest hesitation. We have to support Jar's group with all our might." Still, the incessant factional fights took their toll on the IKD, and most of its members finally gave up in frustration with this contentious man and departed the group, when they were not tracked down and assassinated by Stalin's henchmen, as Walter Held was. Weber and Schussler remained, persisting because of our better policy and understanding, as Weber assured himself. But by the late 1930s, the IKD over which the two men presided was tiny and marginalized, a more or less phantom organization. Politics aside, Weber enjoyed living in the City of Light. He savored the cuisine, the art, operetta, comedy, and satire, irony and serene Catholic sentimentality, pathos and passion, eroticism and the luxury industries. Nowhere else has civilization borne a more beautiful flower on its broad vulgar stem than in France, he remarked. He fell in love with ironic, picaresque French novels, like Diderot's Jacques L.E. Fatalist, in which a nervy protagonist exuberantly defies conventional shibboleths with panache. It was, surely the kind of orthodoxy-smashing role that he pictured himself playing. In early September 1939, at the outbreak of war, France designated all Germans living within its borders as enemies of the French state and detained them in internment camps. Weber was among them and was probably still in such a camp on May 10, 1940, when the Reichswehr smashed through the countryside and reached Paris. On June 14, jackbooted Nazis goose stepped down the Champs-Élysées. The beautiful flower of civilization capitulated to Hitler's thugs on June 25. The Nazis ordered the new Vichy regime to hand over all anti-fascist expatriates living there. Political radicals, labor leaders, artists, authors, musicians, economists, and scientists, most of them Jews, faced the horror of imminent removal by the Gestapo. By the thousands they fled south, bringing only what they could carry. Weber, who recognized the imminent danger from the internment camp, somehow escaped and joined the southward exodus. Marseilles, on the Mediterranean coast, was the last stop. By the time Weber arrived there, the city was jammed with penniless refugees, desperate to leave France. The dissident leftist author Victor Serge mentions seeing the German emigration there, which must be a reference to Weber. Official US policy was to do nothing to help them, lest it rile Hitler, but a rogue official in the US consulate, seeing that the very heart and soul of European culture was urgently in need of rescue, set up a secret operation, issuing exit visas and retrofitting cargo ships to evacuate as many of the refugees as possible. But the ships were too small and few to accommodate all of them. Weber talked his way onto one of the last boats out of Marseilles, as Murray would later put it to me. Perhaps that boat was the old freighter Capitaine Paul Lemerle, which left in March, carrying 300 refugees, 40 of them comrades, in Serge's term. Upon reaching Martinique after a wretched month-long voyage, the refugees were interned in a former leper colony on the island for several months, while the Vichy government tried to figure out what to do with them. Perhaps as Joseph Weber languished in the Martinique leper colony, he brooded on something that one of his heroes, Rosa Luxemburg, had written back in 1915, during the First Imperialist War. The alternatives that civilization faced, she had said in the so-called Junius pamphlet, were socialism or barbarism. If for some reason the international proletariat failed to rise up and create socialism, then capitalism would persist and degrade the world into barbarism. Now, as the Nazis were overrunning Europe, Weber might well have reflected, the world was discovering what barbarism was. It was midnight arrests and internment camps and swastikas and Gestapo, it was prison camps, jackboots, and executions. Luxemburg's words seemed prescient. Finally, the Vichy regime allowed the refugees to depart from Martinique. And somehow, in late 1941 or early 1942, Joseph Weber made his way to New York, where he looked up his American comrades at SWP headquarters. Upon his arrival at University Place, his fellow Trotskyists welcomed him. He was surely an impressive figure, having eluded the Nazis twice. He would have explained to them that the IKD, which he represented, was one of the oldest and most stable organizations of the Fourth International. Under conditions and difficulties about which you do not have the slightest notion, we issued a paper unser Wort in the emigration and up to the outbreak of the war, published brochures, books and documents. And he could boast of receiving the ultimate accolade. Leon Trotsky greatly esteemed our work and never corrected us in a single political question. And he was cultivated and charming to boot. But as odd as the Americans surely were, they were also hungry for news about the coming proletarian revolution. Where in Europe was the proletariat resisting Hitler? They pressed him. Weber had written, apparently on Martinique, an article on that very subject, he told them, and handed them a manuscript called Three Theses. The European workers' movement, the article said, was scarcely breathing. The Nazis had smashed all the labor unions and left-wing parties, they had murdered, imprisoned, and exiled the proletarian leaders, they had prohibited even the expression of revolutionary ideas. As a result, there is no longer an independent proletarian political or workers' movement in the Nazi-overrun countries. All that remains are individuals and weak and uneven groups. Resistance groups do exist, but they are not exclusively workers' groups. All classes and strata participate in them, farmers and priests, officers and merchants, students and professors also resist fascism. They are fighting not for socialism but for national liberation and bourgeois democratic government, with freedoms of assembly and expression. Trotskyists, Weber concluded, must not ignore this reality, they must support this all-class, national, pro-democratic struggle because it is a struggle against fascism. The Americans reacted to the article as if they had suddenly been doused with cold water. It called into question not only the policy and program of the Fourth International but the validity of Trotskyism itself. Felix Morrow dared to venture faint praise of three theses, but Jean van Hayenurt overruled him. Europe's national liberation movements are not our potential allies, Van scolded him, they are obstacles to socialism. The more I read your documents, he berated Weber, the more I am against them. We will see if we have to part company. After that chastisement, Morrow fell into line. Chairman Cannon, for his part, pronounced the article heresy. The journal Fourth International published Trotskyist condemnations of Weber's ideas. Weber wrote replies to them, but the editors refused to publish them. Only after 14 months was the original troublesome Article 3 theses, finally published, in the December 1942 issue, but even then it was accompanied by an official response authored by Goldman and Morrow, explaining to readers that Weber's article was factually wrong. The liberation struggle has actually unfolded under the leadership of workers' organizations and workers' groups and was determined to achieve socialism. Morrow and Goldman pronounced it embarrassing to have to explain to the German comrade the ABCs of Marxism, and they closed the piece with a clincher, some quotes from Trotsky. These indignant regurgitations of orthodoxy must have grated on Weber. After all, he was in the right. The resistance movements in occupied countries definitely comprised people from across the political spectrum. They derailed trains, bombed tracks, and blew up ammunition depots in a struggle not for socialism but for national liberation and democracy. Van, however, remained intransigent. The senior schoolmaster, Weber mused, rejects the whole notion of a democratic revolution. But Weber did praise Morrow and Goldman for writing the reply, they at least honestly wanted to discuss. And his challenge to orthodoxy seems to have shaken them up, for doubts were beginning to percolate in their minds. If Bookchin missed a lot of SWP meetings in 1943-44, he may be forgiven. At the Bayonne foundries, grievances were simmering along with the molten metal. The union leadership, as we have seen, had pledged not to strike. But as the war went on, corporate profits and executive salaries were soaring, while workers' wages did not even keep up with the cost of living. Then in 1943 wages were frozen, even as industry sped up assembly lines and demanded longer work hours. Workers' grievances accumulated, but the no-strike pledge crippled that one muscle that the unions could flex in opposition. To press their issues, the workers were limited to bargaining with management, through shop stewards like Bookchin. Shop stewards during the war were much more militant and aggressive than the national union leaders, according to the UAW, and were truly more representative of the workers than the union officials. In March 1943, a UE local was battling management in a foundry in Bayonne, the Bergen Point Iron Works, which may or may not have been the foundry where Bookchin worked, over issues of wage adjustment, union security, checkoff, management rights, seniority, vacation, dismissal, arbitration, holidays, sick leave, transfer, and grievance procedures. But business and government had no tolerance for worker militancy. A rebellious worker would be warned to find another job or relax his militancy for a while, Bookchin later recalled. Those who failed to heed the warning could be fired. Rebellious shop stewards, for their part, would be called into personnel offices or receive visits from the cops. When shop steward bargaining broke down, workers mounted wildcat strikes, strikes without union authorization. Beginning in the spring of 1943, a wave of wildcats swept through heavy industry. Was the long-awaited revolution arriving at last? No, most of the strikes were of short duration, usually a few days. The wildcats led to mediation, but not to revolution. In New York, SWP members' hopes rose again in the fall of 1943, when they learned that Italian industrial workers were striking at important factories in Milan and Turin and forming workers' councils, that is, Soviets. Trotskyists rejoiced at the first day of the proletarian revolution in Italy, the first day of the coming European revolution. But Weber calmly assured them that the Italian strikes meant nothing of the sort. Nonetheless, in October, an SWP party plenum, infused with orthodoxy, saluted the Italian workers for demonstrating that the workers in alliance with the peasants and colonial peoples will prove capable of overthrowing capitalism. Weber had wanted to attend the plenum, but Van had slyly tricked him into staying away. Outraged that he'd been excluded, Weber rebuked Van that one would have to be blind not to see that the broad masses of Europe are national in their demand for independence. Cannon suggested that the German emigration had a certain psychology and was a little bit screwy. Weber shot back that the SWP had failed to conduct the kind of open discussion that could make possible a correct orientation for the international movement. If the Fourth had followed his advice, early on, and supported national liberation, it could have placed itself at the head of the movement at least propagandistically and agitationally and might have won a substantial influence upon the consciousness of the masses. But instead it had let itself be blinded by orthodoxy. Gallingly, the Stalinist parties had caught on to reality and were now playing a prominent role in resistance movements, and were winning prestige as a result. That could have been us, Weber must have seethed inwardly. By now, Goldman and Morrow were conceding that Weber had a point. Even stalwart Van finally climbed down and admitted that the French resistance included not only workers but large strata of the petty bourgeoisie, and that its immediate objective was not a socialist society but the overthrowing of the German yoke, while its broader aims were democratic and patriotic. Seeing that he was making progress, Weber recounted the International's mistreatment of himself as well. "Do you believe," he asked them, "that the best way of promoting the European Revolution consists of gagging and discrediting European exiles? Who did they want to make the revolution with, if not those rare specimens who have survived the European catastrophe physically and politically?" He had them. Goldman and Morrow admitted their mistake. As for Van, he was becoming a sort of champion of the national question, but alas without, Weber complained, crediting himself. In November 1943, Morrow, Goldman, and Van, joined by Bookchin and Dave Eisen and several others, took the daring step of forming a dissident faction within the SWP, called the SWP Minority, also known to history as the Goldman-Morrow faction. Its members were those who agreed with Weber's analysis. Ever since Max Schachtman's departure in 1940, SWP chairman James Cannon had dreaded the emergence of another faction. He wanted no more splits. Yet now he had one on his hands. Furious, he insisted that SWP members must maintain an undeviating commitment to orthodoxy, that is, to Trotsky's 1938 transitional program. Nothing therein was to be changed, not a comma. Al Goldman complained that Cannon preferred a homogeneous monolith to a revolutionary party. During the war years, he said, anyone who presented any new idea like Weber was looked upon as a disturber of the peace. Bookchin agreed that Cannon was authoritarian. When it came to dissident views, he had discovered to his chagrin, the Trotskyists were no different from the Stalinists. By 1944, Bookchin had toiled for 5 years in the hellish foundry. He'd done his best to organize his fellow workers. He'd handled their grievances and fought the UE's Stalinist leadership on their behalf. He'd tried to teach them Marxism. But they were no closer to becoming a revolutionary proletariat than when he started. So he hung up his apron and goggles and left the foundry. The auto industry seemed to hold more promise for a revolutionary agenda, its proletariat was feisty and assertive, and the United Auto Workers, UAW, was the country's most militant union, a spearhead of labor activism. It was not controlled by Stalinists. At that moment it was waging a bitter struggle at General Motors, the most hard-bitten and reactionary corporation in the world, as Bookchin recalled. Since the war began, GM's corporate profits had doubled and executive salaries had skyrocketed, meanwhile the workers were being pushed to work faster and longer for the same pay. The UAW believed that management was taking advantage of the workers' no-strike pledge. So the rank and file revolted, more persistently and broadly than in any other industry in wildcat strikes. After the frustrations of Bayonne, the class conflict raging at GM was doubtless irresistible to Bookchin. So he took a job in a GM machine shop on 11th Avenue in Manhattan, and got a UAW card. The shorter commute and the less onerous work meant that he could spend more time at University Place talking politics with his SWP minority friends. They expressed their perplexity that no proletarian revolution was in the offing. The war was turning in the Allies' favor, and it was clearly only a matter of time before they, not the working class, defeated Hitler. What were they as Trotskyists, to make of this unexpected turn of events? To address this question, Joseph Weber, who had in the past been right about so many things, came out with a new article long and densely theoretical, called Capitalist Barbarism or Socialism. Published in October 1944 in Max Schachtman's magazine, its title, surely not by coincidence, alluded to that memorable formulation by Rosa Luxemburg, Socialism or Barbarism. In 1915 Luxemburg had written that the world faced a choice between the victory of socialism by the international proletariat, or the triumph of imperialism and the collapse of all civilization. In the absence of a revolutionary transition to socialism, Weber asserted in his new article the post-war world would indeed revert to barbarism. Once the Allies defeated the Axis, the victorious imperialists would dismantle Germany's and Japan's economic and political institutions and drive both countries back to pre-capitalist levels, reducing them to agricultural hinterlands. Then Russia and especially the United States would strip Germans and Japanese of their human rights and resettle them in prisons and ghettos and concentration camps, transforming them into a slave labor force. The imperialist overseers would do the same to every other country that they wished to exploit. Barbarism, in other words, would look very much like the Third Reich, its labor and population policies extended as a world phenomenon. Weber called this vision of decline the theory of retrogressive movement, or the retrogression thesis. The article's bombastic prose style ex cathedra assertions, and esoteric Marxist jargon make for tough reading today. But in 1944 Bookchin found it electrifying. Eager to talk to its author, he made his way to Weber's Bronx apartment. Surely Weber, age 43, was delighted to see the young proletarian intellectual, age 23, standing in the doorway before him. Perhaps as they sat down together, the young man told him about the militant but entirely non-revolutionary proletariat he had encountered in Bayonne. Surely Weber detailed his shabby treatment at the hands of the orthodox Trotskyists. Perhaps he explained to Bookchin about Luxemburg's socialism or barbarism formulation. I was in the KPD when she was still alive. The soon-to-be victorious Allies were already scheming to retrogress Germany and Japan after the war, he must have explained to Bookchin. Only a month before, at the Quebec Conference of September 16, Roosevelt and Churchill had agreed to a plan, developed by Treasury Secretary Hans Morgenthau, to eliminate the war-making industries in the Ruhr and in the Saar and to convert Germany into a country primarily agricultural and pastoral in its character. Stalin, too, was plotting a post-war demolition of Germany's industrial capacity, and he intended to demand huge war reparations, which millions of Germans would have to toil in slave labor for more than a decade to pay. That was how monopoly capital worked, Weber might have explained. The United States, by eliminating its major capitalist rival, Germany, would thereby extend the reach of its own imperialist system, colonizing Germans, making them dependent on itself for manufactured goods. In 1944, it should be remembered, no one had any idea what would happen after the Allied victory. For all anyone knew, the world would sink back into economic depression. Weber's grim scenario would have seemed all too plausible to Bookchin. In his own short lifetime, he had already experienced homelessness and dislocation, tribunals and expulsions, anti-union goon squads, and treachery. Indeed, Weber's retrogression thesis seemed to him a stroke of genius, on a par with Trotsky's 1938 transitional program. Weber himself seemed a likely candidate for Trotsky's successor, perhaps he would even become the next important Bolshevik leader. A few months after Weber and Bookchin's first conversation, the Allies took Berlin, and in August 1945 the Japanese surrendered to General MacArthur. No proletariat in any nation rose up to break its shackles and usher in the socialist order. On the contrary, in the capitalist countries, the workers had ardently supported their respective national war efforts. The Germans had fought to defend Hitler all the way to the bunker, as he put it decades later, still amazed by the fact. And the Russians, perhaps terrorized into submission, or perhaps not, had remained quiet during what Stalin called the Great Patriotic War. The unshakable laws of history that Trotsky had invoked to predict that the war would end in socialist revolution had turned out to be nothing more than his own wishful thinking. To be sure, just after VJ Day, as soon as the no-strike pledge passed into history, the American working class roared to life. Industrial workers from coast to coast went out on strike, demanding full employment and wage increases. By October 1945, the strike wave was gigantic. 43,000 oil workers, 200,000 coal miners, 44,000 lumber workers, 70,000 truck drivers, and 40,000 machinists all laid down their tools. In November, 300,000 UAW workers, among them Bookchin, struck at General Motors. Within 12 months of VJ Day, more than 5 million American workers had gone on strike, although not all at the same time. It was the largest strike the country had ever seen. But after 113 days, the UAW, having exhausted its limited strike fund, ended its strike, accepting a small wage increase and some fringe benefits and contract changes. Workers in the other industries soon returned to work as well, having achieved modest gains. All in all, the captains of industry had prevailed. Then in August, amid the chaos of demobilization, Bookchin was finally drafted into the U.S. Army. For years he had had deferments for taking care of his mother. It's unclear to me what changed in 1946. In any case, he didn't mind being drafted. I was still a Bolshevik. I believed that we should be trained for armed insurrection, and besides, the army was full of workers. Far from being a conscientious objector, he said, I was a conscientious soldier. Private Bookchin, a member of Company A of the 526th Armored Infantry Battalion, was stationed at Fort Knox, Kentucky, the Army's center for mechanized cavalry. Trained as a tanker, he and his unit practiced maneuvers. Bombs blew up around foxholes, and friendly bullets whizzed by. He also served in a more familiar role as an auto parts clerk for the motor pool. While he was away, his friends in New York kept him up to date, by letters, on political developments. At a November 1946 convention, the SWP had charged Felix Morrow and Dave Eisen with disloyalty, for the sin of questioning Trotskyist orthodoxy and for forming the minority faction. The SWPRs in attendance had vilified them. Chairman Cannon had refused to allow Morrow and Eisen even to respond to the charges, and the convention's vote to expel them had been almost unanimous. Bookchin saw clearly that when he got back to New York, he would not be returning to the SWP. In early 1947, the Army terminated the wartime draft in favor of an all-volunteer army, and released all post-war draftees. On June 14, after 10 months of service, Bookchin was honorably discharged. he returned to the apartment he shared with his mother at 710 East 175th Street and to work at GM. The UAW had participated in the huge strike wave before he was drafted. Likely Bookchin expected the UAW to soon mount another strike. But in 1947 the company was rethinking its way of handling its 400,000 blue-collar workers and decided on a new strategy: it would co-opt them. In the spring of 1948, GM offered the UAW a contract with a guaranteed annual wage, benefits for sick leave, health insurance, and vacations, as well as improved working conditions. In exchange, the UAW was to guarantee that its members would not strike for 2 to 4 years. The UAW accepted the contract. Many of Bookchin's fellow workers surely favored the deal, for all the benefits it would provide to them. But Bookchin saw it as a decisive collapse of revolutionary will. A truly revolutionary union would have rejected the contract and forced annual wage negotiations. But the UAW not only accepted it, it went on to phase out union shop stewards and replace them with company-employed grievance men. Worse, it allowed the company to buy off the heads of some UAW locals by paying their salaries. These union leaders would actually become company employees. The GM-UAW settlement of 1948 demonstrated to Bookchin once and for all that industrial proletariat was not revolutionary. Industrial workers might sometimes be class-conscious and even militant, but only in an effort to improve their lot in the existing system, not to change it. Now, as workers removed their union buttons and eyed homes in suburbia, they were identifying not with their class but with the very company that exploited their labor. The change was of epical proportions, Bookchin thought. The proletariat was being brought into complicity with capitalism. Having been a Marxist since the age of 9, the realization came as a shock. For if the proletariat was not revolutionary, then proletarian socialism was an illusion, and Marxism was based on a fallacy. Bookchin left General Motors, dazed and uprooted. Drawing $20 a week as a veteran, he had the liberty to ponder the dizzying change as he drifted around New York. From Union Square, he could see the Daily Worker building, where he'd spent years studying Marxism, and the Trotskyist headquarters on University Place, but both were now out of bounds. Fortunately, he was not alone in his political dislocation. Other refugees from Marxist movements were in the same plight. They were facing the failure of Marxism, just as Western Europe appeared to be collapsing economically. To commiserate and, as always, to discuss what to do and where to go next, they congregated in the low-priced restaurants and cafeterias of 14th Street. Here at Child's or Schraft's, you could get a blue plate special for 2 bits. Even better was Horn and Hardart, the automat, where individual servings of macaroni and cheese or Salisbury steak, or pie waited behind little glass windows. You dropped coins into a slot, and the food came out hot, on real dishes. Another nickel got you a cup of coffee. Here in the cafeteria, Bookchin could sit down at a table with other lost souls and talk freely as they could no longer do at the old headquarters nearby. Here Bookchin met Dwight MacDonald, who was now editing an independent left magazine called Politics. The validity of Marxism as a political doctrine, MacDonald might have said at his table, stands or falls on its assertion that the proletariat is the historical force which will bring about socialism. Since the proletariat had not fulfilled this role, the rock of historical process on which Marx built his house has turned out to be sand. MacDonald was rejecting Marxism, but Felix Morrow, Bookchin learned, had given up on radical politics altogether. He'd taken a regular job in publishing. Even Jean van Hayenuert, Trotsky's old secretary, threw in the towel in 1948. It had been 100 years since Marx and Engels wrote the Communist Manifesto, Van announced, but the movement had nothing to show for it. He ceased political activity altogether and returned to his first love, mathematics, eventually becoming a respected professor. Bookchin must have been relieved to sit down with his old friend Dave Eisen. Neither of them wanted to follow in MacDonald's or Morrow's or Van's footsteps and leave revolutionary politics. They surely discussed the latest brainstorm from Joseph Weber, he had suggested that all the old SWP minority members leave the SWP and form a new, independent group with him. They could start a new magazine, to figure out the new direction collectively. Weber had been right many times, Bookchin knew, and now he was turning out to be right about retrogression. Newsreels were showing skeletal bodies of Jews in concentration camps, stacks of unburied dead, gas chambers, still smoldering crematoria. Bookchin had been reading the transcripts of the Nuremberg trials, the forced labor, starvation, tortures, and enslavement. The Stalinist massacres at Katyn Forest and Babi Yar, the U.S. bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it was all a descent into barbarism. It was retrogression. Weber himself didn't care for the cafeterias of 14th Street. He had showed up there once and sat down to a steaming bowl of soup, only to find a cockroach amid the boiled noodles. He'd flown into a rage, calling the cafeterias hellish inventions, and had stormed out, never to return. A certain percentage of all food eaten by New Yorkers, he judged, consists of roaches or their excrement. New York, it seems, wasn't Paris. So Murray and Dave would have to seek him out on his own turf. When they arrived at Weber's Bronx apartment, his new wife, Millie, might have opened the door to them. He had recently married her, resolving his immigration status. They all sat down amid the German books and papers and surely talked about their great shared dilemma. Everyone understands something is wrong, Weber might have said. That something is the failure of the socialist movement to lead society under conditions most favorable to it, war and its aftermath. And Marxism, as the theory and praxis of the proletarian revolution and the dictatorship of the proletariat, was dead, absolutely dead. On that they all agreed. But socialism? To give up on socialism would be to accept barbarism. And as a devotee of Rosa Luxemburg, Weber could never do that. In 1939, Weber might have continued, Trotsky just before he was killed, had said something very important. He had said that if somehow the unthinkable should happen and the Second Imperialist War ended without a revolution, then we should doubtless have to pose the question of revising our conception of the present epoch and its driving forces. In other words, Trotsky had said, if the revolution didn't come, we would have to rethink the socialist project. Rethink socialism with me, Weber might have said. So we don't end up with the barbarism of retrogression. He'd been circulating his 1944 article manifesto, Capitalist Barbarism or Socialism, to his friends in Germany. Those who agreed with the retrogression thesis were starting a new magazine called Die Neue Zeit. The first issue had just been published, dated June 1947, the month of Bookchin's discharge. Weber's plan was for the group to publish an English-language sister edition, to be called Contemporary Issues. The new journal wouldn't be like the old Trotskyist organs, suppressing discussion, insisting on one-party line. Contemporary Issues would have no dictatorship of the editorial office. Instead, it would let ideas and theory develop from facts. It would actively encourage readers to participate, to raise objections and doubts, to challenge its editors and writers. No topic would be off limits. Murray and Dave, in the end, agreed to work with Weber and his international comrades. Together they would choose socialism over barbarism.